What if I told you that every human who reaches Mars is trapped there forever, unable to ever return to Earth? This isn't science fiction, speculation, or distant future talk. This is the cold scientific reality we're facing right now. The human body, after spending years on Mars, becomes so fundamentally altered that Earth's environment turns lethal. We're not discussing missing technology or insufficient funding. The limitation isn't rockets or fuel, it's biology itself. Millions of years of evolution have hardwired our bodies for Earth's precise conditions. And once we spend extended time on another world, that programming gets rewritten in ways that can't be undone. What happens to astronauts on Mars is so extreme, so fundamentally transformative, that the body crosses a point of no return. Today, we're breaking down exactly why Mars is a one-way ticket, examining the science behind each irreversible change, and exploring what this means for humanity's dreams of becoming an interplanetary species. A Mars mission represents one of the most extreme endeavors humanity has ever attempted. While reaching the moon took merely 3 days, traveling to the red planet requires between 6 and 9 months each way. This means astronauts will be separated from Earth for a total of 2 to 3 years minimum before they could even contemplate returning home. 2 to 3 years during which their bodies face unprecedented stress, and the distance is merely the opening act of this challenge, at approximately 34 million miles at closest approach. Mars sits so far away that even light signals take over 20 minutes to reach Earth. An emergency evacuation? Impossible. A medical crisis? The nearest hospital is 8 months distant. These astronauts will be isolated like no humans in history. But the real crisis isn't the distance or the loneliness. The real crisis is what happens inside the human body during this voyage. A Mars mission exposes the body to 3 completely different gravitational environments. First, weightlessness during the 6 to 9 month outbound journey. Second, Mars's reduced gravity at only 38% of Earth's. And finally, if return is even attempted, the full crushing force of our home planet's gravity. Each transition represents an extreme challenge for our physiology, but the interaction of all 3 over a span of years produces consequences. Scientists still don't fully understand what they do know, however, is deeply alarming. The human body is meticulously optimized for life on Earth. Remove our bodies from this environment for extended periods, and a gradual transformation begins, a process that after crossing a certain threshold becomes irreversible. Astronauts who spend just 6 months aboard the International Space Station often require weeks to walk again after returning. Their bones become porous, muscles atrophy, hearts deteriorate. And this happens after only 6 months in orbit, where rescue remains possible, and Earth sits just 248 miles below. On a Mars mission, this time frame at minimum triples, and coming home isn't a guaranteed option. Let's examine in detail what happens to each biological system during this journey. In weightlessness, bones don't need to support the body's weight. Our skeleton interprets this as a signal that it's become unnecessary. On the result, bones begin dissolving from within. Astronauts lose approximately 1 to 2% of bone mass per month in zero gravity. That might sound small, but over a 2 to 3 year Mars mission, we're discussing 72% total bone loss. To put this in perspective, osteoporosis patients on Earth typically lose 1 to 1.5% bone density per year. Mars astronauts would experience bone loss 12 to 24 times faster on the spine. Hips and legs suffer the most severe damage. Bones become so brittle that a simple fall on Mars, even in reduced gravity, could shatter them catastrophically. Upon attempting to return to Earth's gravity, the skeletal system would face forces it can no longer withstand. Standing upright might cause compression fractures in the spine, walking could break legs. The astronauts' own body weight becomes a weapon against them. Currently, astronauts aboard the ISS exercise 2 hours daily, using resistance equipment to combat bone loss. Even with this intensive regimen, they still lose significant bone density. On Mars, with limited resources and demanding work schedules, maintaining such exercise intensity becomes nearly impossible. If you enjoy deep, evidence-based space discoveries, be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you won't miss what's coming next. Muscle atrophy, strength, vanishing. Muscle deterioration follows a similar devastating pattern. Without Earth's gravity constantly challenging muscles, they atrophy rapidly. Astronauts can lose 20-30% of muscle mass during a typical 6-month ISS stay. On a Mars mission lasting 2 to 3 years, muscle loss could reach 40-60% or more. The legs suffer most dramatically. After years on Mars, where gravity is merely 38% of Earth's, leg muscles adapt to this reduced workload. They become precisely calibrated for Martian conditions, perfect for Mars, catastrophically insufficient for Earth. Returning to Earth's full gravity, these weakened muscles would struggle to support even basic standing. Walking would be agonizing, if not impossible. Climbing stairs might become as challenging as scaling a mountain. The astronaut would essentially need to learn to walk again, but with muscles so severely compromised that full recovery might never occur. The heart, itself a muscle, faces similar deterioration in reduced gravity. The heart doesn't need to pump as forcefully to circulate blood throughout the body. It shrinks, weakens. It becomes less efficient. Upon return to Earth, this weakened heart would struggle to pump blood against full gravity, leading to fainting, dizziness, potentially life-threatening cardiovascular collapse. Wait, you might be thinking, can't we just exercise more, train harder? That's exactly what scientists thought too. But here's where it gets genuinely disturbing, because what we're about to discuss goes beyond bones and muscles. We're talking about changes so fundamental, so deeply embedded in our biology, that no amount of exercise can prevent them. So stay with me, because the next systems affected, they reveal why Mars truly is a one-way journey. Beyond the visible deterioration of bones and muscles lurks an even more insidious threat: radiation. Earth's magnetic field and atmosphere shield us from the relentless bombardment of cosmic radiation and solar particles on the journey to Mars. And while living on the Martian surface, astronauts receive no such protection. During the outbound voyage, astronauts would absorb approximately 300 millisieverts of radiation on Mars's surface. Even with habitat shielding, they'd accumulate another 200 to 300 millisieverts annually. Over a 2 to 3 year mission, total radiation exposure could reach 900 to 1,200 millisieverts. For context, radiation workers on Earth are limited to 50 millisieverts per year. The cancer risk from this level of exposure is profoundly elevated, but cancer represents only one concern. Radiation damages DNA directly, causing mutations that accumulate over time. It accelerates aging at the cellular level, degrades cognitive function, impairs the immune system. The most disturbing aspect? Much of this damage is permanent. DNA doesn't fully repair itself. Cellular aging can't be reversed. An astronaut returning from Mars would carry this radiation damage for life, facing elevated cancer risks, potential cognitive decline, and accelerated biological aging. Weightlessness causes bodily fluids to redistribute upward toward the head on Earth. Gravity pulls fluids downward, maintaining proper pressure-pull balance. In space, this balance disappears. Fluid accumulates in the upper body and skull, creating constant pressure against the brain and eyes. Many astronauts develop what's called visual impairment intracranial pressure syndrome, VIIP. The optic nerve swells, the eyeball flattens slightly, vision deteriorates, sometimes permanently. Some astronauts report vision changes persisting years after returning to Earth. For a Mars mission lasting 2 to 3 years, this vision impairment could become severe and irreversible. The brain itself faces similar pressure-related damage. Studies show astronauts experience slight brain structure changes, including expansion of the ventricles and shifts in gray matter distribution. Long-term cognitive effects remain poorly understood, but early evidence suggests memory, attention, and decision-making capabilities may decline. After years on Mars, would an astronaut's brain still function optimally in Earth's gravity? Would their vision recover? Scientists honestly don't know, but the evidence suggests the answer might be no. The immune system, our body's defense against infection and disease undergoes dramatic weakening in space. Studies on ISS astronauts show reduced T-cell function, impaired antibody production, and reactivation of dormant viruses like herpes simplex and varicella zoster. Why does this happen? The stress of space travel, combined with radiation exposure and altered sleep cycles, suppresses immune function. On a Mars mission, this immunosuppression would persist for years, leaving astronauts vulnerable to infections, potentially including Martian microbes if any exist. Even minor infections that would be trivial on Earth could become life-threatening on Mars. And if the immune system's impairment becomes permanent, returning to Earth's microbial environment, where countless pathogens constantly challenge our defenses, could be catastrophic. Here's the central question. When does all this damage cross from recoverable to permanent? When does an astronaut pass the point of no return? Scientists don't have a definitive answer. Research on ISS astronauts provides data up to about 1 year in space. A Mars mission would last 2 to 3 years minimum. We're extrapolating into unknown territory, but evidence strongly suggests that somewhere between 18 to 24 months, the cumulative damage to bones, muscles, cardiovascular system, vision, brain, and immune function crosses a threshold. Beyond this point, full recovery becomes increasingly unlikely. The body has adapted too thoroughly to low gravity conditions. It's been reshaped, rebuilt for Mars. Attempting to readapt to Earth's crushing gravity after years of adaptation to Mars would be like asking someone who's learned to breathe underwater to suddenly breathe air again. The body simply can't make the transition back. So what does this mean for humanity's Mars ambitions? It means the first Mars astronauts must accept an uncomfortable truth. They're not explorers who will return home as heroes. They're pioneers embarking on a one-way journey. They're becoming Martians. Future Mars colonies won't be temporary research stations. They'll be permanent settlements. People born on Mars might never be able to visit Earth. Their bodies, developing in 38% gravity, would be completely unsuited for our home planet. Earth's gravity would literally crush them. This fundamentally changes how we think about space exploration. It's not about planting flags and returning with samples anymore. It's about committing entire lives, entire bloodlines, to another world. It's about accepting that some humans will evolve biologically and culturally into a separate branch of humanity. Can we reach Mars? Absolutely. We have the technology, but that's not the real question. The real question is whether we're ready to send people knowing they'll never see Earth again, whether we're prepared to split humanity permanently into two separate worlds. The journey to Mars represents humanity's greatest challenge and biggest commitment. We've explored why coming back might be impossible, why the human body itself becomes the ultimate barrier. But here's something more immediate, something happening right now. The Red Planet isn't some distant dream anymore. NASA and SpaceX have real plans, real timelines, real spacecraft under development. The first crewed missions could launch within the next decade. So while we've talked about why you can't come back, let's talk about the actual journey there. Curious about the practical details? Click on my video here. We break down the exact journey times, the launch windows, the propulsion systems being developed right now, and the realistic timeline for when humans will first set foot on Martian soil, because the mission? It's closer than you think.